recall from the last couple of weeks, we have found ourselves in Corinth, where tensions are high. This ragtag group of people, as Reverend Leanne called them a couple weeks ago, find it increasingly difficult to live in community, which, if we're being perfectly honest, is not too far from today. Paul is charged with the task of bringing these people back down to earth, back to reality. But in doing so, we find that Jew and Greek alike are both set in their individualism and what they know to be true. It's here that we find ourselves. It's here that we find Greeks and Jews both bringing to question the foolishness of the cross. First, we wrestle alongside of the Jews who can make little sense of the cross at all. Why would an all-powerful God send an all-powerful Messiah that can be seemingly dismantled with wood and nails? The cross did not represent power. The cross represented weakness. And the Greeks, with all of their earthly wisdom, and it's earthly here that is key, because earthly wisdom is human wisdom, which is flawed by design, because we humans are nothing if not flawed. It's this earthly wisdom which makes the Greeks question the cross. Why didn't God send a magical Jesus? A Jesus who could just poof, and everything would be better, just a matter of their thought. Why wouldn't God send a military leader who would just corral everybody by force and put everybody back in shape? That's not how God works. God wants us to come of our own free will. God doesn't want us to be coerced into following the Lord. God wants us to recognize all on our own that we actually need the Lord. So what did God do? God sent us a preacher, one whose story is told through life, death, resurrection, and ascension. And it's here that we find Paul, reminding the people of Corinth that those who are weak will be made strong, and those who are foolish will silence the wise. Hear now the word of the Lord from 1 Corinthians, first chapter, starting in verse 18, which is not for my plus, so bear with me. Just one moment.
It's all good.
Oh, look at that, we're good. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many of you were powerful. Not many of you were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce things that are to nothing, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. God is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, in order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Originally, I was supposed to preach on the 22nd. big part of our lives in the last several years. Not only that, we were actually named as godparents. And so to accommodate our being able to be there and be present with them, Leanne and I did a big one. That being said, I'm not going to lie to you when I tell you that when I first read this passage, I was not a happy camper. I tossed my pencil down, I pushed my way back from my desk, I crossed my arms across my chest, and with attitude, not unlike the children that I watch on a regular basis, I called out to the heavens, "No, I don't want to." Why couldn't I have kept last week's passage? That passage seemed easy. The whole "let's everybody just get along" thing, that seemed nice, you know? Good. This one, upon my initial reading, this one made me mad. I read this, me, who has a degree, a political science degree at that, me who is probably more qualified to run for certain political offices than other people, me who is capable of finishing a sentence without fragments all over the places, me, I put myself in the role of the wise. Because with all of my earthly human wisdom, I was definitely wiser than other people. And if that were the case, then from this perspective, I would be the one who was made foolish. And that did not sit well with me. Even more so, and I'm sure many of you will sympathize, it did not sit well with me that those who I perceived as foolish were going to be used by God to lead us all into salvation. No, absolutely not. I don't like it, it's not nice, no. I did not want to preach this sermon. But it was then, in my moment of temper tantrum, honestly, that I realized, Jesse, you are foolish, and you're being dumb. For God so loved the world, not just bits and pieces, not just the people that I liked. God loves the whole world. We have been called to love God and to love our neighbor, even when we don't like them. And it was then that I realized that I was depending on my own flawed human wisdom to understand this passage. And it was when I stopped and waited in anger, but was still, that I understood that those who were perceived as wise would be the ones who would be made silent. And those who were perceived as strong would come to know that even their greatest strength isn't as strong as God's weakness. And that's the difference. The reality is, I was wise. And in that blatant moment of temper tantrum, I was made silent. Literally. All parents know, all child care providers know, all teachers know, that after a temper tantrum usually comes two things, the first of which is the silent treatment. And it's as if in my huffy, puffy fit, God literally was shaking God's head going, "Hello, this is what I'm talking about. Be quiet!" My arrogance, my need to feel better about myself, to make myself seem better, but because clearly to me, my moral and intellectual compass was pointing in a much clearer direction than others, was only achieved by me putting other people down. I asserted myself as judge and jury, and I made myself stronger, and I made myself better. And in doing so, I became no better than others who I was accused of doing the same thing. So yes, I needed to be silenced. I needed to be made foolish. Because it's here in my foolishness that I can see how unbelievably sorry I am. Which is the second thing, by the way. First comes the temper tantrum, I'm not talking to you. And then comes the emotional groveling for forgiveness. I'm sorry. It's here. You know it. It's here that I can see where the work needs to be done, both in myself and around me. It's here where God can make a fool of me over and over and over again God can also bring me back up to rise. Mm-hmm. We are all going to have these moments because we are all flawed. Mm-hmm. We are in need of a want, a punch of godly reality, of pushing past our ego and falling into a very divine sense of love. And it draws back to Micah, where we are called not only to act with justice and to love kindly, but to walk humbly. Mm-hmm. It's when we let ourselves be silenced, when we let ourselves go down, that we can come back up again. But only when we lean not on our own human understanding of the world. On the 21st, last Saturday, I had the profound opportunity to participate in the Women's March on Washington. I was joined by over 500,000 sisters and brothers, some of whom are from this church. And I understood that several of you spoke last week about your experience, and I honor your stories, and I pray that this won't be redundant, and instead just an expansion of the testimony that you spoke last Sunday. That number, that 500,000 and counting, only speaks to those in Washington, D.C. It says nothing of millions of other men and women who march all over the country and all over the world, from cities in Africa and Asia and Australia and Europe, to even the meager 125 who marched in Columbia, Maryland. On that day, people all over the world united and were reminded of the significant role that women play in all of our lives. Janelle Monáe, who's an actress and a singer, at the march reminded all of us that if it weren't for Mary, we would not have Jesus. What an important role she plays in bringing up the Son who would become our Savior. Likewise, if it weren't for Joseph's commitment to Mary, his ability to not run in fear when an angel appeared to him and told him of this important role that he would play in his child's life, if it were not for his trust in the Lord that everything would be okay, then the narrative of Jesus probably would have read a lot differently. We give thanks for the men in our daily lives, and for those who marched last weekend, we give thanks for their voice. We give thanks that so many of you have chosen to use that voice for bringing awareness for the need for equality in our very disheveled world. The privilege that you hold, even when you don't see it, even when you don't realize it, is powerful. And I, for one, am grateful that those in this room and those who were at the march last Saturday have used and will continue to use that power for good. As the rally continued, we cheered as Alicia Keys belted out, "This Girl Is On Fire," with 500,000 energized voices singing right alongside her. We rallied as our elected officials, including Kamala Harris and Tammy Duxworth, spoke of their literal bodily sacrifice, a sacrifice so they might be able to better defend the Constitution of the United States of America. We were motivated as Michael Moore repeated the number that we could call to contact our congressional representatives so that they might hear our mighty walk, our rally cry of "We are here, we are here, we are here." We were broken and taken aback as Ashley Judd, a three-time rape survivor, slammed her way through a raw lamentation of how we women will not be disregarded. I screamed, the crowd screamed, and I am pretty sure nobody was as loud as Sarah when the leader of the teachers union rebuked the appointment of someone who has thus far demonstrated no real intention of investing in the future of our children. Tears were shed as the mothers of the movement, the mothers of those we lost to unlawful abuse of power, including the mother of Trayvon Martin, sang out, cried out for us to say his name, say her name. We were moved. We were motivated. We were inspired. And it's hard for me to pick favorites. two speeches that stood out to me above all of the rest. The first was by a young girl named Sophia Cruz. Sophia Cruz is a six-year-old girl from Los Angeles who wrote and then physically handed a letter to the Pope. She was fearful because she didn't want her two parents, her two undocumented parents, one of whom labors 12 hours a day in a Los Angeles factory. She didn't want them to be deported. What happens to us, she asked, if they're sent away? She likewise met with the president, President Obama, and had a similar letter for him. 6 years old, and already she lives with the burden of wondering what will happen to her family under our new administration. 6 years old. In front of a crowd of over 500,000 people, she had her speech memorized. Memorized in English and in Spanish. And she spoke to the children and the youth of that crowd, and let me tell you, there were a lot of them there. And you know what she told them? She told them that they were powerful. She told them that they, too, had a voice. She called upon President Obama's words as she led every single one of us in chanting, "Si se puede." Yes, we care. She spoke strongly and unwavering when she told us, "Do not be afraid. You are not alone. Amen. God is with us."
Amen.
And in that moment, I was not 28 years old. I was six. And no words were of greater comfort to me than Sophia Cruz's. And they will be led by a child. And so she is. The other speaker that most touched my heart and honestly brought the entirety of my sermon together was Van Jones. Van Jones is a political commentator for CNN, as well, you know, as a champion for human rights and, you know, the world at large, put in And you might recall his emotional appeal after the election, as he reminded us that across the country, and really across the world, parents are waking up to having to figure out how to explain across the breakfast table that the world is not what we imagined it was going to be. On Saturday, he spoke as a representative of the Love Army. He told the crowds that hateful rhetoric cannot and will not be tolerated. He said that while conservatives need to be better conservatives, liberals, well, they need to be better liberals. He said that none of us, regardless of our party, can walk around saying, "Love Trump's hate," while also spewing lies and hatred ourselves. He implored to us that we are called to fight for all of humanity. We are called to fight for the rights of all. Friend and enemy alike, we will fight. Even when we don't agree with you, we will fight for you. We will fight with dignity, for your dignity. He reminded us that it won't be easy, because loving never really is. But when it gets harder to love, we will love harder. When it gets harder to love, we will love harder. When it gets harder to love, and it will, and it has, we will love our neighbor anyway. We will love hatred and lies and betrayal and fear in the face, and we will love our neighbor anyway. And we will love. In Matthew, Jesus tells us, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, those who are meek, those who are hungry for righteousness, those who are pure in heart, the peacemakers, the persecuted, for your reward is in heaven." when that privilege is called into question, when we are forced to recognize the position of power that we hold, that we become aware of the inequalities in our ebb and flow. And it's when we become aware that we can become the change that is needed. Several months ago, I adorned my car with a Black Lives Matter sticker, not to be trendy or cool, but because I actually truly support the Black Lives Matter movement. And with doing so, I actually believe, as I know everybody in here does, that Black lives really do matter.
Amen.
Living in Laurel and its diversity, my sticker was never questioned. No attention was ever drawn to it by myself or by others. It wasn't until we moved, until the week leading up to and then following the inauguration, that anything was ever said about it. That being said, it wasn't until these last 2 weeks that I was woken yet again to to my own security and my own privilege. This abrupt alarm came when on now 5 separate occasions, various people have purposefully cut me off in traffic, brake checking me every 10 feet or so. It came when obscene hand gestures were made and make-believe guns were pointed at me through windows. It came when obscenities were shouted as cars passed by. It came when I was stopped at an intersection and yelled at not only about my Black Lives Matter sticker, but also with the intent of calling me vile names in regards to my sexuality, saying to me that I should know what it is to want to matter. It was when I realized how easy I have it here at Oakland, or in Laurel, where we all love each other, despite our differences. But out there, loving gets harder. It was in that moment when my wife asked me if I was going to take that sticker off with my car that I realized that I had a choice to make. I had a choice that a lot of other people don't have. I could take that sticker off my car and life would be quieter and traffic would be safer, but that was not the choice that I was going to make. Yes, I could remove that sticker, but what would that say to my Black brothers and sisters, all of you in this room, who can't remove your skin, who have absolutely no reason to be ashamed of the skin that you're in, but you are ostracized, and you are hurt, and you are killed because of it? What would it say to you if I were to remove that sticker and take a nice, easy breath? When my Black brothers and sisters are tired and are yearning to breathe free. Perhaps Lady Liberty was not too far off the mark. The truth is, friends, that one march, 2 marches, 5 marches, it's not going to solve the problem. It might not even make a dent. But what it will do and what it has done is alert us and all of those around us to bigger problems. And as moving as the events were on Saturday, what they continue to do is shed light on the greater issues of divisiveness within our global community. We can rejoice in the fact that 0 arrests were made on the streets of Washington, D.C., even when we were close to 1 million strong. That's a wonderful thing, having a peaceful protest. But do you know what other protests are peaceful? Black Lives Matter demonstrations, the Dakota Pipeline demonstrations, just to name a couple. Do you know what happens at those demonstrations? People of color are arrested for doing the same thing that millions of white women and white men did last summer, which is assemble peacefully. I have read and heard over and over again that people of color weren't afraid for their safety last Saturday. Not because they were confident that DC police were going to privilege is powerful. We must awaken ourselves to it. Our work is not over, friends. Not when men and women of color are valued at 3/5 of a person, despite what any constitutional amendment might say. Our work isn't over when our Muslim neighbors still have to live in fear of being registered in their own country, or being denied refuge, or are asked to leave and not come back. Our work isn't over when immigrants in this country have to wonder every night if they're going to be able to go to work in the morning without some ignorant man or woman telling them that they don't belong here, or if they have to wonder if lists will be made reading out crimes that they may be committed, as if we were living through the era of McCarthyism all over again. Let us not forget that we are a country founded on immigration. Our work is not done when our LGBTQIA brothers and sisters have to wonder if the new mandate among naysayers, it won't just be to pray away the gay, but to electrocute it out of them. Our work is not done. God chose what is foolish to silence the wise. God chose what was weak so that the strong might be weakened. God chose what or who was despised in the world to reduce those who were not to nothing. So that if one boasts, they boast in Jesus Christ, the life, the death, and the resurrection. God chose those who were perceived to be at the bottom to silence those who were at the top. We have been called friends. We of varying races and ethnicities. We who are young, we who are young at heart. We who have found our way onto the soil in search of better opportunities, not only for ourselves, but for our children. We who are able-bodied, and we who find day-to-day tasks to be a bit more challenging. We who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, intersex, and asexual. We who are men and are not intimidated by our own fragility. And we who are women, whose strength has been surely underestimated. We are called. We are called to act with justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly.